there is a need right now for a profound boost towards freedom. A big boost. Let that be your mantra, your prayer. Say, I ask for a big boost towards freedom right now. We all know it's necessary. We need to all pray for that big boost in whatever way. It's a general invocation, a general prayer for a big boost. It can come in whatever way God's grace decides to provide it, that is fine. But we need to focus now, all of us, on prayers for a big boost. This is being contemporary. This is being in the moment. This is having awareness of the situation for those of us, those who are perfectly awakened. They realize all this is just a dream. Those who are not yet awakened are having their attention buffeted and pulled this way and that. Very severely, the dream is becoming very rambunctious. So it's important for those who are still somewhat asleep to receive a big boost so that they can wake up. Otherwise, greater enmeshment in the dream is certain to take place, despite the ego's promises to the contrary that it can go easy. No. We must recognize the ego for what it is. And let's give credit to the Course in Miracles for helping out with that. It did a great job. Very, very great job at that. Non-dual teaching has done a very great job at also in pointing towards freedom. But doesn't touch on the ego so much. Tends to just sort of brush it aside, which is fine. It's a very advanced type of teaching, actually. Non-dual teaching is extremely advanced. I don't believe that many realize that. Slight problem, because it seems like a shortcut. And you can just say, you know, go to satsang and, you know, just abide in the self. And it seems very simple, very easy. But it's actually the teaching developed in a spiritual culture that was reached great advancement. And it's kind of like a shorthand for very, very advanced spiritual aspirants, non-dual teaching. Super advanced. Basically, it assumes you already have all the basic ducks in a row. You have everything already lined up pretty much. You understand the world's, you know, what's going on. It's a dream. You understand the ego is just an illusory power. So many, many premises are already in place. And then from that point, you are given a focus. The non-dual teacher gives you a focus. And quickly, that can then result in the vision of oneness, dropping the false identity. But this is really designed for very advanced spiritual aspirants. When you take this teaching and apply it to immature aspirants, then there is trouble. There is some trouble there that I've noticed. So what I did was I first took the Course in Miracles. I used that, which gives you a tremendously strong foundation in truth. You're able to have a very, very set and stable set of premises. You understand the big picture, very panoramic understanding. From there, then it's easy to use non-dual teachings and apply them correctly. But if when I listen to questions that people raise in satsang, I'm always struck by the questioner's lack of grounding in the basics is amazing. These people sound like beginners. And I don't believe that the non-dual teaching is effective for them. They kind of, because it's so advanced, you have to already have a very strong understanding and acceptance of some powerful basic truths. And I believe Ramana Maharshi said that. He said, this is very advanced teaching. Those who came to him were almost already liberated. And then he said, look, just abide in the self. You know, very basic, simple advice, but was completely profound. And there were a few then who could accept this. But as we try to export this on a mass scale, it fails. It really does. Of course, everybody is looking for the shortcut. We live in a culture and civilization that has been indoctrinated into laziness, let's put it that way, where we simply, the ego says, look, just go along with the ego's plan and spirituality, you know, truth, will develop some sort of technology for that, so don't worry about it. It's all taken care of. There'll be some pill you can take. There'll be some easy shortcut where you really, you know, you don't have to really work the basics and really work hard on all of this stuff. It'll be easy at some point, so don't stress about it. That's the ego saying that. In contrast to that, the teachers that I have been associated with have always stressed the extreme importance of enormous effort on the spiritual path. You name it, they've said it. Okay, Ananda Mahima, Ramana Maharshi, Jesus Christ, those are my teachers. And then Muji also. But the first three certainly have placed an enormous emphasis on tremendous daily effort, non-stop daily effort, which is what I've done. And that there is no shortcut. Ramana Maharshi said, you know, anyone who realizes has had to put in a tremendous effort. There's no way around this great effort. But somehow the modern consumer culture believes enlightenment is a product or a grade that they receive, and they're just trying to find out, how do I get this grade? How do I get the teacher to give me an A? How do I buy this product? They're approaching it from that standpoint to a large extent. And they're demanding that it be easy. But it's beyond easy. It's profound. It's a great step forward. It's a great step into. It's a great releasing. A great releasing. It's a end of searching. It's a giving up of the effort to replace reality, giving up the effort to develop a new identity, giving up the effort to develop a new reality. It's completely profound. And that's all that it is. There's not some other kind of enlightenment or freedom or awakening. There's not two different types. There's not freedom and then freedom light, you know, bud and bud light. So many are trying to find the diet freedom. Freedom light, L-I-T-E, less calories, less effort, no such thing. In fact, that only makes things worse. So the real problem in this world is systemic. There is no easy fix for it at all. we have been overly impressed by certain factors which have made us lazy, have turned our heads around. Something superficially impressive has impressed us enough to get our attention away from a very solid work ethic on the spiritual path. And this is done intentionally. And I've brought this forth in other videos I've done throughout the years and the months. There has been an infiltration, a changing of the guard on this planet, very much so. And this changing of the guard is basically says, don't worry. We got it all under control. We know what we're doing. We know where we're going. Just go along with us, and everything will be just great. But where's that coming from? Has any spiritual teacher ever advocated that? No. Spiritual truth remains the same. The classical path of spiritual effort remains the same. There are no miraculous shortcuts to the effort that you need. What happens is you can get a taste of freedom, but without the strong foundation, you will then go back and try to integrate that with the ego, and you'll end up going around talking about building a better world, more peaceful world, which of course is not what any teacher advocates. Because that, again, only benefits the ego. So you get a culture and a society with a lot of spiritual talk from those who are trying to integrate truth and lies and believe that they know how to do it, which is not a good thing at all. And then most people will look at that and say, yeah, That this is great. This is what we want to do, and you have therefore you have a world that is truly lost. Things actually get worse. You know, it's. I advocate a culture and society based on spiritual practice and endeavor, and contemplation and meditation and satsang. A world culture that is based on that, not consumerism, materialism, any of that. Very simple. Externally, it would be very simple, very basic. Nothing razzle-dazzle special at all. But internally, subtly, freedom would be actually being realized. We don't have that anymore. That's gone with the wind. So the opportunity here in this world is superficial, where spiritual teachers and teachings here I have seen is very much part of a compromise position between freedom and non-freedom, between safety and non-safety, between truth and lies, between true identity and false identity, between endlessness and the imagined idea of the end of endlessness, between reality and the attempt to replace reality, between God the Prime Creator and Spirit's attempt to be the new Prime Creator. It's an attempt to accommodate both positions. And that is the booby prize. That is what you don't want. So I give it an F, a fail. These times and the effort that's been made is a big fail. And you have to, the first step in success is to recognize failure If you don't recognize that whatever is taking place is failing, you won't be able to fix it. So it's not a bad thing to recognize it's been a failure. We failed. The world has failed big time. But from that acceptance comes a sense of true optimism and hope. All of the spirituality that has blossomed over the last 100 years has failed because it was not those who tried to adapt it were not grounded in a very strong fundamental truths, which is that's where the tough work is. It's kind of like we tried to superficially coat ourselves with a veneer. You know, you look at so many products in the world now, they look so beautiful, I'll tell you this, it's all veneer. All the hardwoods, you look in a house and you say, oh, look at these hardwoods, they're so beautiful. It's a very, very thin veneer over pressboard. We live in a pressboard world with superficial, beautiful veneers. And we think that, you know, we're you know, rich, we're enriched, all this. Same thing with our spirituality. It's a veneer. It looks very beautiful, but on the inside is just pressboard. It's a compromise. Rarely do I hear anyone speaking with that is pointing to freedom from compromise. And even more rare is anyone coming to them and listening to that and hearing that. And the teachers complain about it. The real teachers do. They say, you know, it's very frustrating here in this world. It just nobody seems to be getting it. That's because the ego is presenting very tantalizing options and getting people to work on those. And you can't do it both. It's very difficult to do both. The spiritual path is a career. It has to be number one in your life. It can't be shared with something else as far as number one. It can't be co-number ones. They're not co-redeemers. The ego's not a co-redeemer with the Holy Spirit. But the truth is that we try to accommodate the ego. We believe the ego has some authority. And so we want to please both the ego and God. And so we think we've come up with ways to do that. We're trying to come up with a spirituality that pleases both. And therein lies the problem. And when you take a teaching that doesn't try to please the ego is shocked. The ego will be stunned and will be very upset. Because the ego believes it has some authority. The ego wants you to listen to what it says, and it believes it can fashion a compromise. It actually believes it's superior to God, because it was born of the idea of spirit wanting to be superior to God. So the ego has this superiority complex. And so it believes it can, where God can't, the ego believes it can. In other words, the ego believes it can make both truth and lies be true. That's its fundamental belief. And when any listening to the ego, any giving any authority to it, that's the direction the ego will take you in. But ultimately, that's that too. The ego is just a compromise, temporary. Ultimately, it wants to completely supplant the authority of God. But it will tell you, as it leads you in that direction, it will tell you that you can have both. Don't worry, you can have both. You can both have enlightenment and unenlightenment together. You can see both the real world and the non-real world. You can experience both true identity and false identity at the same time. But the ego never makes good on its promise. You only end up experiencing false identity and then conceptually trying to realize. You keep your efforts going to realize true identity while you abiding in false, while you... So the ego gives us pressboard promises. The veneer is always peeling off. We look beneath the veneer a little bit and we say, oh my gosh, it's just a thin, superficial thing. The ego tells us, don't look at that. Just look at the surface. Don't go any deeper. Only see the surface. So when I hear those coming to satsang and the questions, the way they are, they don't want to upset the ego. So they're trying to please both the teacher and the ego at the same time. And they're very dutiful to the teacher. And they'll listen and say yes and thank you so much. And I'll try it on that. But they're also, you know, kind of like worried that they don't want to upset the ego. They don't want the ego to think that they're giving full authority to the teacher's teaching. They want to share it. They want to be tolerant of both. Share the authority. And it's very difficult to see that this is impossible. But this is the grounding that's so important. A Course in Miracles gave that grounding to those who have used it. To see what real teaching is all about, uncompromising teaching. To become familiar with that. Enough so that you can see what the ego is up to. Realize that it's not going to work. It brings about a certain spiritual maturity from which it is possible then to take the plunge to realize the ever-present truth becomes possible, and to realize it not, and then not try to integrate it with the ego's teachings or the ego's point of view. Just to simply abide in that, as Ramana says, his teaching is simply abide in the one identity. That's basically all he's saying. Just stay there. And so you have to be very advanced to be able to accept that exhortation. That's really those who went to Ramana Maharshi. He was simply abiding in that continuously, unbroken abidance. And then they would feel that and say, ah, that's what, you know, is necessary. Okay. In our culture today, most spiritual seekers want an experience, some kind of blissful experience, like a drug experience. But they're not really looking to permanently abide in the self. That's the big step. There's a huge difference between trying to get a hit of bliss and actually permanently abiding in the self. It's night and day. And over the last 100 years, we've developed a drug culture, both recreational drugs and pharmaceutical drugs, where we don't realize how enmeshed we are in that, where we are looking for experiences, varieties, and we want to find a spiritual experience. We want to kind of flirt with it and get an experience with it and to add to our portfolio of experiencing. It's like we're trying to enrich the false identity through giving spiritual experiences to the false identity. The identity that we're trying to construct to replace the one identity. We're trying to give experiences that to that identity to mature it, so to speak. That is not a spiritual path. That's the ego's path. So the ego will certainly send you to teachers and say, you know, get a hit of truth here and bliss, whatever. But the ego's purpose is to try to develop, to evolve the quote-unquote false identity, the new identity that we're trying, we're working on to replace the one that already is. That's what we're doing. That's the delusion that we're under. We are working to construct, evolve a new identity. And we believe in order to evolve this new identity, we need to give it some sparks of spiritual bliss. So we look for teachers who can give us that. And the teachers are always saying, you know, frustrating. You come here and you get a little bit and then say, okay, I got it, and then you leave. What's taking place, again, is that's the ego's is directing them to get a little spark of this, a little dash of that, in order to try and evolve, to, you know, move the evolution of consciousness along. The evolution of consciousness means the development of a new identity. That's what we're trying to do. So, Sri Anandamayi Ma said that in truth, there's some approached her for truth. There were some, but relatively very, very, very tiny percentage. Most did not come for that. Most came to get something for the false identity, to help evolve the false identity. She's very honest, very open about that, saying, you know, only very small number came for truth. Every teacher echoes the same thing. Papaji Punjaji, same thing. He didn't, you know, said only seen a few yanis in his whole life, and many that came to him, he said, you know, they're trying to get a hit of truth for their egos, for the evolution of their consciousness. So, the evolution of consciousness, that is the ego. That's not God's plan for salvation at all. God's plan for salvation is to free us from that, free us from the ego's plan. The ego's plan has this veneer, superficial veneer. But it's really nothing at all. We cannot replace identity because identity is endless. Our identity is endlessness. That is our identity. Endlessness is omnipresent, the quality of it. Because it has no defined quality. Endlessness is the quality. It's an overflowing transcendentness that is omnipresent. All time, space, and situation exactly the same. Never different. So how can there be an evolving of consciousness? That's nonsense. What is present right here now has always been present right here now. And present everywhere. Always equally present. This feeling of omnipresence, that is the true feeling. That's the one feeling. Some call it love, all-inclusiveness, equally present everywhere. No space to turn around in, because it is everywhere, everything, allness, endlessness. That's what we're called to abide in. That's what Ramana called us to abide in. Meaning unbroken feeling of this. Not an experience of feeling it, but unbroken feeling of this, acceptance of this. entirely, without trying to be something else, without trying to integrate it into something else, with something else. And the ego laughs at this and says, you know, that it has a better plan. Of course it will say that. It says that the integration of truth and lies will be more powerful than even truth is by itself. Which is, of course, just total nonsense. What is there to integrate with endlessness? An end to endlessness? It thinks, the ego says that the integrating the end to endlessness with endlessness is going to create more endlessness. Just, it's just complete babbling nonsense. At its very root, the ego is just complete nonsense. But it's able to put a spin on all of it. It can sound very, very, very sophisticated, but it's actually just babbling incoherent nonsense. And it doesn't want you to see that, but you need to see that. Don't be afraid of it. It's really kind of amusing. There is no end to endlessness. So how can you integrate an end to endlessness with endlessness? Completely absurd. The ego is completely absurd, but we want to give it some sort of sophistication. So we allow for some spin, allow it to at least seem dignified. But therein lies the problem. Because once we accept some of its spin, it adds spin to that. It never stops spinning. Spin is all it has. Spins out the logic of plausibility. But it's all based on complete gibberish. So when people went to see Ramana, he simply continued to abide in the self, the one identity of endlessness. And the gibberish didn't get anywhere. It just became obvious. Wasn't anything for the ego to grab hold of, really. So one either simply accepted that and moved towards stepping into the oneness, the one identity, or one left. So the big boost is to come across those who simply abide in the one identity, is to realize that that is the goal. There is no other goal except to abide in the one identity. And that the ego is just complete gibberish. Its foundation, its premise is absolute gibberish. Rantings of a lunatic. There's nothing to make of it. But the ego's fantastically clever at spinning it all into plausibility. That's all it's got. But you cannot engage the ego at that level of spin, because it doesn't stop the spin. It only has spin. It knows it has no case. So when you deal with the ego, you deal with someone who's desperate, who knows they have no case whatsoever. It's like a lawyer defending someone who's completely guilty, and the lawyer knows they have no case, so they just try to spin it off in some crazy direction, ridiculous direction, to into confusion. And they hope to confuse the jury to the point where the jury says, ah, I can't really decide on a verdict. It's too confusing. That's the ego. The ego knows it has no case. The ego's aware that at its root it is, it's simply completely confused. It has no clarity whatsoever. So engaging with the ego, you're engaging with an absolute desperate villain who will mislead you entirely, spin you into confusion. And when you engage with someone, you automatically extend them the courtesy of believing that they're capable of reason and give and take and understanding and clarification. You automatically extend that. When you extend that to the ego, you're lost, because the ego has none of that. The ego's a complete desperado, an insane desperado who has no case. It's trying to sell you something you can't possibly want to buy. It's selling you nothing. It's asking you to trade everything for nothing. It knows you're never going to buy from it, so it's desperate to delay the inevitable. It doesn't want to be made aware of its confusion. So you cannot deal with the ego. That's why Ramana said, simply abide as a self. Don't try to make deals with the ego. Yet the world is full of those who believe it's possible to make a deal with the ego. Those are the clever ones. Those are the ones who seem to be so clever and smart and confident. But it's superficial. Underneath is a world of confusion. So, spend your time hanging out with the true teachers, the true gurus, the ones who abide in the self, abide in the one identity, without making any attempts for a second one or any compromise, uncompromising. Difficult for teachers. They can't travel everywhere all at once. The internet is one way to help spread that mujjhis, helps spread that throughout the world through the internet. So one doesn't have to travel, do a lot of traveling expenses and difficulties, etc. Like for me, I won't get shots. I won't get inoculations. I won't go to other countries that require that. Can't afford to travel in the first place. Lots of troubles traveling. So the internet makes it possible to have satsang in that way. Very valuable, very helpful actually. I've tested it out and it is very, very helpful. It might be more helpful to have an intensive with a teacher. But there again, a lot of people cannot afford that right now. The practical reality of the situation is there's haves and have-nots. The world is segregating into haves and have-nots. Literally, the middle class is getting wiped out. The plan is to divest the middle class of all their money and redistribute it to the poor. Why? What the plan is in this world is for a controlling ruling class. And a class that is indoctrinated and regimented and roboticized and very controllable and pliable. And the plan is to give all the money to those sheep, the robots, so that they, and then they can easily be told where to spend it. So it seems to be a very ideal society where everybody consumes according to what they're told to consume. They spend according to what they're told, how they're told to spend. And those who have free will, free choice, who want to be free to use the money they want in the ways that they want to, they're being wiped out. The plan is to completely impoverish and turn them into complete destitution and wipe them out. In other words, if you want money to come to you and you want to decide, well, I want to do this with it based on my own intuition, you're targeted. You're supposed to have no money at all in the future. Zero. You're supposed to die. And the money is going to be given to those who spend their time watching television, who are willing to be programmed into being good consumers. Quote unquote good people, meaning good consumers. In other words, any business person wants to be able to control their business, wants to be reliable, predictable, so they can estimate costs in the future, plan ahead properly. They want stable markets, and therefore they want a stable clientele. They want the clientele to be predictable and stable. So there's been a massive push to indoctrinate the world to become predictable consumers. And those who are not predictable consumers are being phased out. The plan is to crash the world economic system to dry up money for everyone and then redistribute it in a new system where everybody is willing to be monitored. Their activity is completely monitored so everyone can be guided and pressured and directed into how to spend their money. That's the plan. And we see that right now in March of this year. We see drastic steps in that direction. Point of this being that many people in the future won't have any money. Don't have money to travel, don't have money to go intensives. That's ridiculous. Who has extra, $5,000 just lying around, plus, 2 weeks to take off and travel? Only the haves have that. Many of the middle class now are just struggling to pay their bills and can't pay their credit cards, can't pay their mortgages, can't pay their gasoline. They're going under. It's all by design. It's on purpose. There literally is this big push to wipe out those who don't want to be in the class of the controllers, the elite, but want to be in a class of having freedom to spend their own money the way they want to invest the way they want to not be overly taxed, to get the fruits of their labor back to them so that they can decide what to do with it, who want to use that in ways, intuitive ways, to benefit their spiritual growth. That entire class of people on this planet is targeted to be wiped out. And it's happening. It's happening very, it will happen very quickly. Everyone will be given, some type of ID, financial ID card in the future where everything is monitored. Right now, the new privacy policies and internet giants of tracking everything you do online. Your purchases will be tracked. Everything you buy and credit cards, etc., that all be melded into one database. And you will then be part of a society where everything you do is made known to the elite class. And you will become like a sheep. No freedom. No freedom anymore on this planet. That's almost here and will happen. This changeover will be very rapid. So, what I am doing, having foreseen this, is providing a way for those on this planet who truly want freedom to have access to it online. Have access to a big boost online. Don't have to travel. Don't have to spend a lot of money for intensives. Just need an internet connection, or you can even go to a Wi-Fi spot somewhere. Get it for free. And you can succeed in this manner. You have to. And we will make every effort to give you a big boost in this manner. with the remaining time that we have. The time is extremely short. This has always been emphasized to me, and I've been always emphasized this in all my videos, that we're running out of time. Time is very short for this economic plan to take place. I say there's going to be a complete crash of the world economic financial systems on purpose, so that this new regime can be instituted. Where the amount of money you have is delegated to you by the elites based on your willingness to buy into the system that they are now implementing, willingness to be tracked in all facets of your life. This will be seen to be a good citizen, really, really good citizen. You don't realize that you're accepting bondage, slavery. You think that you're being, you know, environmentally sensitive and all this stuff. It'll be sold all sorts of wonderful spiritual veneer, with a wonderful spiritual veneer of how conscious you are, how you're evolving your consciousness by doing this. But what it really is the ego's plan to get rid of any capacity on this planet to move towards freedom, for people to have the money to spend, for instance, to spend to go see a guru, to go to guru intensive, etc. For those who cannot be controlled, who want to have their own money to use for their own purposes, which can be used, of course, to gain access to true spiritual teachings. That's the real target of this entire situation. So, and realizing all this ahead of time, I've worked steadily to make available on the internet profound teachings and connections with truth, with that which is abides in the one identity entirely, without a second, without a search for a second one, without making contingency plans in case the one identity ends. You still have access to that as you get more and more undermined. You still have access to this, so make use of it. That's what it's here for. Continue to make use of what you have quickly, because time is running out. And a choice will soon have to be made. All right. We'll bring this broadcast to an end. Take a deep breath. Everything's okay. We just need to continue moving very quickly by leaps and bounds. Very great. That's it.